This is Sammy and Company. Starring Sammy Davis Jr. The music is by the George Rhodes Orchestra and I'm William B. Williams. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Sammy.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I gotta tell you, I've said it
several times in the past about special shows and all of that kind of jazz, but this is very special to me because out of this season's Sammy and Company, this is the only one that we're doing that originates in New York City. And I'm back. I'm back where I think I belong because I was born in this city. Almost 50 years ago, and it is a ball to be back, and particularly near the street where I had the pleasure of living for a while. Two separate occasions called Broadway. And tonight, what we're doing is, well, let me put it this way to you. It's just groovy to be back. To the people in the audience, in our theater, and to you nice folks at home, we got one to lay on you tonight. Hank, if you will. The most beautiful girl in the world picks my ties out, eats my candy, drinks my brandy. The most beautiful girl in the world. Most beautiful girl in the world isn't Garbo, isn't Dietrich, but the neat trick who can make me believe it's a wonderful world. Social, not a bit. And I think you know she ain't got no platinum hair. That face, the face that I see belongs to Liza, the one begins with a Z. She's got my crazy heart in such a tangle. It drives me simply wild. From any angle, ladies and gentlemen, Miss Liza Minnelli, if you will. Another face, a taste. It just isn't fair. When she moves, she grooves, and all others stare. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Chita Rivera. And nowhere will this eye of mine behold some finer grace than that face, that face, that face, that face, that face, that face. Hey, you stay with us, because this is going to be something else. I can't use no. If anybody wants to applaud for this great man, Mr. George Rhodes.
You.
there's something very special about coming back to Broadway for me. Because ever since 1956.
Yes, I think so.
Yeah, but it was 1956.
And you're telling the world.
Well, we can't deny the fact that we did Mr. Wonderful together.
That's right.
And you people sure look at that Decca record and they go like this. You mean they was around in them days? But when I come to New York, whether it is to play like the Eurus Theater in the old days, the Copa, whatever it was always kind of special for me to catch Broadway shows. Because if you're working a nightclub or you're working a theater, you can't catch nightclubs particularly. You can only catch matinees. And I try to catch all the in shows. Now, the in show, there are three in shows this season. One is called Chorus Line.
Absolutely.
One is called, which was choreographed, conceived by Michael Bennett. One of the other shows is called The Wiz.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And the other one is called Chicago. Now, Chita, you've been with Chicago from the concept. Liza came into Chicago and did one of the most unusual things that's ever been done. No, I really mean it. She walked in and in 5 days learned a part.
I'm glad you still got it straight. It was 5 days.
5 days learned it. Never had her name, no publicity, nothing, because the magnificent, marvelous Broadway star by the name of Miss Gwen Verdon got polyps on her throat and had, and she volunteered, she suggested. As a matter of fact, it was first said, I think, to an outsider behind my bar. You know, I'm like this, and I remember very well because I said one of the great things of all time, being Mr. Showbiz, 45 years, I went like this. And then next to a guy on the Titanic asking, can I get some more ice? This was one of the brightest lines ever said. You must be crazy. Why would you want to do that? And I yelled at her because she's like my daughter, right? And
my hair stood on it. Why are you yelling at me? Stop yelling at me.
But how did you do it? I mean, really, literally.
Well, I just said, Jack and I were coming to New York. We're coming to New York, and the first thing, of course, we wanted to see was Gwen and Chita in Chicago. Because it's Fred Ebb's show and this whole thing. And we know the score, and we've been through the rehearsals and on the phone together all the time. And he said, well, you're not going to see Gwen because she's got something wrong with her throat. And it's, you know, and she's so upset, she's worried, and this, that, and the other. And she has to have it removed, or she might damage herself permanently, yeah. And that's awful. And we've all had throat trouble. And something popped out of my mouth that even scared me. I said, I'll do it. But just like that. And Fred Ebb turned to me and went, what? And I said, I'll do it.
Freddie picked it right up, didn't he?
Right again. And then Jack said, that would be terrific. So after
Sammy
I made
said,
that first, yeah, and then Sammy said, are you crazy? And then he said, okay, when do you want me to come? When I open, and sent me 47 things of flowers. Do you remember the dressing room? I cannot tell you. You
no,
couldn't get in the, it was like Bugsy Siegel's funeral, my dressing room. Because of you, it was just, you couldn't wait through your flowers.
But it's so funny to me, because it would be to me like my saying, in the old days when Richard Burton was doing Hamlet on Broadway, my saying to Elizabeth, tell Richard if he's not feeling well, I'll go in tonight. Now tell me what the first line is.
Oh, that's what it was like.
Are you crazy?
Are you? That's what she would have said to me. Are you crazy? Is you? No. Is you crazy?
I had the best time I've ever had in my entire professional career, ever. And learning, like you said, so fast, and being that nervous, and I've got to do it.
How do you learn that fast?
Because you open your big mouth and you say, "I'll do it," and then you find out that you're stuck, and you think, "Oh, I can't remember the next step, and I'm gonna faint," and you hyperventilate a lot. And you call Chita a lot. Say, like that. But she came in and helped me every second. Everybody was terrific. You know, Fred, Ebb, and John Kanick flew back in. Fosse came back in. Gwen was dear and stayed on another day just to show me what the show was like. And she didn't have to. She really shouldn't have for a throat. Yeah. And I love all those people. Those people made me who I am. Chita too, because she's influenced me so greatly as a person.
But you guys are so loved, and I don't know if the people, and maybe in the Midwest or whoever's watching the show, whether it's around the world or whatever, know that there are very few performers who are loved by performers. There is always that touch of, you know, a sort of envy. Oh. How come they got it and I ain't? You know, how come they got the part? But I'm sitting between two ladies who have never had that problem, which is remarkable in this day and age. Because, for instance, in Las Vegas, she knows it, and I know it. I don't know if you know it, because you just recently got into clubs, which I'm going to talk to you about. Oh. But the thing, we have a performer's award. I won it 3 years in a row. Mm-hmm. She won it 3 years in a row.
Oh, wow.
And it was absolutely unbelievable because one year, I wasn't even there.
Really?
No, I didn't go to Vegas 1 year, and I won it. And it was the finest compliment because it is half what the kids think about you, because only
really
the waiters.
Yeah.
It's your peers.
Yeah.
The waiters, the performers, the chorus kids vote for you.
The best.
Which really means where it's at. When I walked backstage and saw you in the show, I said to myself, how does she do it? You've just finished. Now, I know I'm supposed to have the busiest schedule in the world, and I think that I'm up there somewhere near the top.
Oh, I'll see.
But I just saw her finishing a picture. You know, I'd seen her finishing a picture with Burt Reynolds, Gene Hackman, and directed by Stanley Donen, called Lucky Lady. And the thing that comes to my mind is it all by osmosis, Liza, or do you say, hey, I'd like to do Broadway now. Now I'm going to do another film. How do you pick it?
I don't know, but I sure needed something after being on a boat for 6 months. You know what I mean? I needed something to get back to my roots, to where it started, and I needed to learn more. I was literally on a boat for 6 months. Do you know what that can do?
But you were smart enough to pick up the chance when it happened. I mean, there's something obviously that
I wanted to cheat. I mean, you work in the theater. It's wonderful to be a star, you know.
Yeah.
And it's swell to be able to go out there all by yourself. But it's really swell when you can go out there with people who are as talented, if not more so, than you are.
But doesn't it?
And it gives you something. It fills you in again.
Sure it does. I mean,
gives you blood transfusion.
You do the same thing every day.
I want to really get into this. We'll be right back after a word from our sponsor, Colgate Palmolive. Please stay with us. I'm beginning to get that deja vu again, that I've been here before. We had a technical problem. We had to do it a couple times, because I try not to lie to my audience, you know, and that's it. But it is very funny that every once in a while, most of the good things that have happened to me song-wise have been brought to me by friends. For instance, my man, Tony Newley, wrote songs, and I got a chance to record them and got most of my gold records that I have hanging in the house. It don't take up but a closet. They ain't that many. And Liza brought this song to me long before Chicago became into being. And she's recorded it, and I'm going to record it, and I'm going to also impose upon Liza, if she would, to do one of the marvelous songs from Chicago called I Am My Own Best Friend. You know, it's so funny that this young lady has recently celebrated first anniversary being married to what is basically like my brother. He's taller and a couple of shades lighter. And his name is Jack Haley Jr. And they've celebrated. And the reason why I can take the liberty of saying this to Jack, what I'm about to say musically, is because Altavies, my wife, was matron of honor, and I was the best man. And this is for you, Jack. Look out. Hey. Somebody stole my gal. Somebody stole my pal. I mean, somebody came, Jack, you were the one, and took her away. She didn't even have time enough to tell me she was leaving. Those hugs that I love so, I'm gonna steam him now. Jack, you're kidding now, I know. Chita,
what?
Having done, I know for me, you go back to Mr. Wonderful, that's when I first met you, but you've done shows like Bonjour, West Side Story, and you've done other shows, I know, before you got to Chicago, but, I mean, before you did Chicago, I should say. There's a thing that you have, and we talked about it earlier, we hit upon it briefly about Gypsy's digging you.
Mm-hmm. She's the best.
Well, is she the best gypsy?
No, she's the best dancer.
But I was a gypsy. You know, I came from the course.
And she never changed. You know what I mean? She never got snobby or anything like that.
But I mean, how do you maintain it? I know I went through three or four cycles, which you were part of, a couple of them.
I think that you just don't make a division between yourself and any other performer that's on that stage, whether they be chorus or bit player or if you are the star. You just don't make a separation. You belong to that one unit. And you make them realize that you feel that way. And then you're all one. I mean, that dressing room, I don't like it up there by myself. I mean, I would prefer to be down there with the kids.
We're down there every minute.
Every second, girl.
Well, when I came backstage, I remember seeing Liza. You guys were, and everybody, it was sort of open sesame.
That's right.
And that's marvelous. But we know, too, and let's not kid the people, that isn't
the
cardinal rule.
No.
Because star is star. Chorus is chorus.
Yes.
Feature player is feature player. So that when I say that you're loved by the gypsies and she's loved by the gypsies, that makes it something very special. Because you know me, when we did Wonderful and when I did Golden mm-hmm. Boy, hey, the first thing I want to do is make friends with the chorus kids mm-hmm. or the performers in the show, mm-hmm. as well as the stage hands and everyone else.
There's a number I do in Chicago called You Can't Do It, I Can't Do It Alone. And that's true, you cannot do it alone. Yeah. I mean, you've got to have the help and the love and the care of everybody in that whole play. I mean, the play is the thing anyhow, isn't it? Without everybody, a part of it, then the play is, you know.
Are you tired? No, a lot of people do not think like that.
That's true.
And the bigger you become, the less you think like that. A lot of people do. That's what I mean.
Yeah.
Chicago's been not only good for Gwen, a marvelous experience for Liza.
And for us with Liza.
But is that what you want to do, or are you going to go back? Now, wait a minute. I got to ask the question.
I know, Eddie.
Because you opened up you did a nightclub act while they were getting the show prepared, and you upset the West Coast. Now, do you want to go back and do that, or do you
want... Oh, yes. I want to do that. That was a fabulous time for me, because, unfortunately, Bobby got sick, you know, and he was put in the hospital in the heart and the whole thing. And we all said, my God, what are we going to do? I'd moved everything from California. Lisa was in school here, yes. The animals, the whole thing. And the furniture was rented. You know. So when Bobby got sick, the furniture went, what? We have to go back to the shop. I mean, nobody knew. So.
Now, wait a minute. I must tell the people, because we can't assume that everybody knows who Bobby is.
Oh, I'm sorry. Bob Fosse.
Bob Fosse, yeah. Got sick, and there was a delay in the production of the show.
About 4 months.
Right. Bobby. And your daughter, Lisa.
Right.
Right?
I think I'm in my living room right now.
Right, that's it. No, but I'm just saying, I got to let the nice people know,
yes.
Because I think it's so interesting. Yes. I know it, but I wanted them to know.
So, anyhow, Bob Fosse did get sick. And then Fred Ebb and John Cantor, our dear, dear friends, and Ron Field, said, let's do something. So I said, okay, what? And they said a club act, and that frightened the devil out of me. I mean,
the furniture went, whew.
Yes, the furniture did relax. And so, and so we did it, Sammy. Now, we thought, I mean, for nothing, right? Absolutely shoestring all the way. When Bob Mackie and Ray Aguillon, the great dress designers, came to see in California, I had this $99 outfit on, and I was dancing and singing and thinking I was cute. And it worked. I mean, they walked in, and I'd go, $99. When they charged thousands of dollars. Thousands.
Oh, that's cute.
Anyhow, well, we did it at a place called the Grand Finale.
Yes.
For the first time in my life, I guess I was ready for a club act. I felt so close and so comfortable with the audience as myself, not as another person, not as a character hiding behind some, you know, hat or some other character. But I was Chita, and Freddie knew how to make Chita Chita, you know, and Ronnie did too. And it was nice to get in touch with myself for the first time in my profession.
Well, I got a flash for you. Chita being Chita is, that's like a Renoir. It is really like a Gauguin. It's one of a kind.
Thank you.
Because you are one of a kind. I am lying to
you. Sammy, thank you so much. I have to tell you what Liza did, because Liza came to the grand finale where the club act opened, and my boys were Tony and Chris Chadman, and
first of all, the stage is this big, the grand finale. It's really the size of the
very tiny
thing that we're sitting on here, and they dance and sing and carry on, and I'd never seen anything like that in that small an area, and so exciting.
Okay. Liza just was screaming and yelling, and then she came back and said, Jack and I would like to present you in California. Well, I mean, we just said, okay. And off we went to California. I mean, you know, after all these years, someone says they want to do something like that. Liza threw the best party. I'm so sorry you all weren't there. I mean, had she known you would have been there knowing Liza. She threw the best party with... At one point, I was sitting between Gene Kelly and Fred Astaire in the dressing room, and I said, well, I know I have to die, so let me go now. And now is the time to go. It's every dancer's dream. Well, it was that caliber of thing, and
When it happens in our business, when it happens, it is so groovy. I remember there were certain nights like that for me. You know, the Royal Command performance, being with certain friends and buddies. It's happened privately a couple of nights. Mm-hmm. When you get a chance to watch Liza do all of Chicago in your living room prior to her coming to do the show, you know. But you have those kind of moments. We've had a few where we sit up and just gypsy it away and dance for all you. There's one number that you do, which I know ain't no sense me doing a whole bunch of show business dance. You done rehearsed it. But I wish you'd do it for me, because she stops the show.
And it's the first number.
And it's the first number of the show. So, ladies and gentlemen, here from Chicago is one of its stars, and one of the brightest stars that ever shined on Broadway, my lady, and I love her, Miss Chita Rivera, doing all that jazz.
Come on, babe, why don't we paint the town? And all that jazz, I'm gonna rouge my knees and roll my stockings back. And all that jazz, start the car. I know a whoopee spot where the gin is cold, but the piano's hot. It's just a noisy hall where there's a nightly brawl. And all of that jazz. Shoes on. Ooh, and all that jazz. I hear that father dip is gonna blow the blues. And all that jazz. Come on, babe, we're gonna bunny hop. I bought some aspirin down at United Drug. It makes you shake a heart and want a brand new start to do. Are they? Yeah.
Wait. Let's not go hysterical here, folks. No, let's not go hysterical here. Just because a girl gets a chance to do that. Give me that last part of that. Go back. Go back. Whoa.
There's no sense in talking about this great band that we've been able to get. I would like, since Liza was nice enough to do a song called My Own Best Friend, written by John Kander and Fred Ebb, and Chita just wrapped it up doing her thing. There's one song in the show, and it's one, probably one of the most frustrating things in the world, is to see a show that excites you as a performer. And there's nothing you can do about it. Meaning, you know if they ever make a movie of it, you ain't got a shot at it. If they ever go on the road, nobody gonna watch it. But I love this song for many reasons. First of all, there was a man called Bert Williams, who was very special to us. When I say us, I mean us as performers, and particularly us as black performers. I think he was probably, let me be corrected if I'm being, the only black performer to star in the Ziegfeld Follies. Now, in those days, turn of the century, there was the blackface comedian. Well, we don't have to worry about the makeup. Good, I'm glad a few people got it. But he had a way about him. He was elegant, but raggedy, meaning he always dressed well. But it was just a little ill-fitting. And he would palm a house. Palm a house. It would take him 3 minutes to get on stage. How the two brilliant composers ever thought of doing this number, which is performed when you see the show magnificently by Mr. Barney Martin. It is performed brilliantly. But this is as much Bert as you're ever gonna see. I don't mean me doing it, I mean this song. If someone stood up in a crowd and raised his voice up way out loud and wave his arms, shake his leg, you'd notice him. If someone in a movie show yelled, "Fire!" and they was in the second row, this whole place is a powder cake. You'd notice him. And even with not clucking like a hen, everyone gets noticed now and then. Unless
Of course, that personage should be invisible, inconsequential. Me. Cellophane, Mr. Cellophane, should have been my name, Mr. Cellophane, 'cause you can look right through me, walk by me, and never know I'm there. I tell you, cellophane, Mr. Cellophane, should have been my name, Mr. Cellophane, 'cause you can look right through me and walk right on by me and never even know I'm there. Now suppose you was a little cat residing in a person's flat, who fed you fish and scratched your ear. You'd notice him. Suppose you was a woman wed and sleeping in a double bed with one man for 7 years. You'd notice him. A human being is made of more than air. And even if you're little and tiny, somebody gotta know you there. Unless that human being happens to be unimpressive, undistinguished, me. I hope I didn't take up too much of your time. We decided to do Sammy and Company on Broadway. And we had the good graces of these. I had my two friends join me, Chita and Liza. I thought it might be a nice moment in the show to present to you maybe a young person who had just exploded on the Broadway horizon. And I couldn't think of no one better than this young lady.
Oh, boy.
Who is the star of a successful show called The Wiz. It's the winner of 7 Tony Awards. And for those of you who may be living in some place that you don't know about what's happening on the Broadway scene, it is a black version
of The Wizard of Oz. They call it The Wiz. It won every award it could possibly win, including Best Musical. Would you please welcome the Dorothy, Stephanie Mills.
Of a place where there's love overflowing. I wish I was home. I wish I was back there with the things I've been knowing. When that makes the tall suddenly the raindrops that fall, they have a meaning, sprinkling the scene, makes it all clear. Maybe there's a chance for me to go back now that I changed its face, but I still know where I'm going. I have had my mind spun around in space, yet I've watched it growing. And oh, and if you're listening, God, please don't make it hard to know if we should leave the things see. Tell us, should we try to stay, or should we run away, or would it be better just to let things be? Living here in this grand world, it might be a fantasy. But it's taught me to
to me how you can get in front of an audience if you're a performer, and sometimes you rev them up. It's happened tonight on three occasions, when Liza sang, when Chita sang, when you performed. How old are you, Stephanie?
16.
You're gonna get it, Stephanie. You're gonna get it, Stephanie.
I'm gonna, you ain't gonna get a chance. Wait a minute. You ain't gonna get a chance because I'm gonna slap her before she gets there. Now, you're a star on Broadway and an award-winning show. What kind of a, how's that affected you in your own life? I mean, does it affect you, or have you, you know what I'm talking about. Are you a show business kid, or are you just normal?
I'm the same. I'm still bratty like I used to be. I mean, it hasn't affected me as being starstruck or anything like that, or getting into a real star thing, though, because I still go to school with regular kids and everything, so.
So in other words, you don't, you go to a what's the school?
I go to a private school.
What's the school at?
The
Performing Arts?
Performing
Arts, yeah.
No, I don't go there.
Well, how did you get picked for the wig?
I auditioned. I auditioned about 3 times. At first, I didn't want to audition because I didn't think I was going to get it. But then I had a record out at the time, and the producer, Ken Harper, he heard my record and he wanted me to come in and audition. So I did, and finally I got the part.
Well, it's unbelievable because I started in this business, as did Liza, as did Chita. I don't know about William B. So we all start, no, we all started out as young, as kids, doing our thing, performing, whatever, this, that, and the other. Did you start that same way? Were you performing when you were... When you were 3 years old?
My sister used to take me to church. We used to have this little storefront church, you know, those Holy Ghost things and stuff. You know? And we used to go to church, and I used to get up and sing and pretend I was shouting and stuff like that, like all the other people. And that's how, you know, and then I kept singing in schools and talent shows and stuff. And my sister would go to college, and I'd come go down there for homecoming and sing and stuff.
Where are you from?
Brooklyn.
How big is your family?
Oh, it's real big. I have 2 sisters and 3 brothers. I have a sister, Judy, that's an actress. Mm. She would kill me if I didn't say that.
And what's the reaction of the rest of the family that you've been accepted by the Broadway elite, so to speak, meaning the critics, the people who come and seeing your name up there and all that jazz, what has been their reaction to that, your family?
I think the most one who's it really affected was my mother. Because she's thrilled with the whole idea. I mean, she really loves this, like, she's playing Dorothy, you know? She's gonna do something.
Is she a show business mother?
No, she's not really, but she's really my backbone. She's really the one that
she's
kept pushing me. Yeah. Kept pushing me and keeping me into it, because I'd get discouraged when I didn't get auditions and stuff.
Well, you know, it's so funny sitting here talking to you about your family. My family was in the show business. My mother's in the audience and all that jazz, and she was a chorus girl. Cheetah's daughter has now got her own career going, and of course, Liza's mother was the first of the super, super, superstars.
Well done. I got a good story to tell you.
Liza just said she has a good story to tell.
I have a good story to tell.
Tell.
About
them.
Well.
About you.
It involves kind of everything. Because, as you know, Mama was the original Dorothy in the movie. Now, my husband's father was the original Tin Man. So, you know, it's daughter of Dorothy, son of Tin Man. We walk around together. And now, Jack comes in to New York, and he wants to go and see The Wiz. And he said to his father, come on, you got to come with me. And his father had a reaction that is not uncommon, you know. He was in the real thing. He said, I'm not going to go see anything. The only thing was the movie and it'd be desecrate. What are they doing? So forth, and rock music and this, that, and the other. And Jack dragged him there, kicking and screaming. He was like, he really just said, well, now he's sitting there and he watches the show and he really starts to like it. But Jack has to translate all the street talk to him. why'd that can't get a laugh. He's a vaudevillian. You know, of course, Jack Kelly Sr. is one of the all-time great vaudevillians. So my husband's translating to his dad. At the end of the show, they got him up on the stage.
Yeah.
And he marched out, and they said, tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we're so proud to have the original Tin Man from the film, The Wizard of Oz, with us. Jack Haley. Well, the place went, what? And he walked out and just was so proud. And he did a marvelous thing. He said, you know, this was the last theater I played in. These were the last boards I was on. But I played over in the 46th Street Theater, and I played the Majestic, and I was at the Imperial for a while. And he named everything in all the shows. He said, so I feel like I've got a right to pass judgment. I'm old enough and cranky enough. He said, this show is terrific. Now, the great thing is that now my Jack is saying, how's he going to get off? Because he's a writer, too. Right? So he's saying, what is it? And he said something wonderful. He said, I know that Mervyn LeRoy is coming, and I know that a lot of people from the movie have been here. And he said, I'm only sorry that Bert and Judy...
Yeah.
Didn't see it, and just walked right off.
Uh-huh.
Place went, whoa!
Yes, that's fine.
And I am, too. You are so wonderful.
It's so funny how you take and translate things into various ways. I got a question I got to ask both of you, everybody on the panel after this. We'll be right back after these words. Stay with us, please. This young lady who started young, you started young. Now that you're happily married and all that jazz, and you still got your career going, what's gonna happen with the family? I mean, in terms, do you want kids, Liza?
Oh yeah, sure I do.
But I mean...
I keep reading that I'm pregnant, and I am not pregnant. I don't care what anybody says.
I don't know how you could possibly get pregnant with your schedule. I mean that, because you're going... I didn't mean that in bad taste. I just meant the lady works so hard. Because I went down to Mexico, saw what she was doing on that boat. You're doing a picture with your dad.
Yeah, next.
And after that, you do a picture, another one.
Yeah, and then... You're gonna be a godfather. Get ready.
I'll lay back and read, man. Now, Chita.
Yeah.
How did you feel about? There's one question I've always wanted to ask you. You did West Side, and you were lauded critically. Yet and still, when they did the movie, I'm gonna lay it on you. When they did the movie, Rita Moreno, who's a marvelous performer, got the part. Did you have... What was your feelings, man? Because I know if it was me...
You want to know what my feelings are?
No, that's not true. As a matter of fact, it's kind of boring, I guess, for most newspaper men, because they really want to hear you say, I had a nervous breakdown, and I was in the hospital, and I hate her, and first of all, she did a fantastic job, as we all know. But thank God, I must say, I did have Bye Bye Birdie, you know.
Yes.
And thank you, and it was a wonderful show with Dick Van Dyke. I mean, it was just a super show. And it didn't bother me, Sammy. Now, I don't know what would have happened if I hadn't been working, you know? I mean, to be active is a very important thing. And creating at the same time. If I had to do it all over again, I would still do it the same way. Because there's nothing like being in the original company of anything. Being there when it is created. And if I had a choice of the film or the play, I would choose the play. That's just the way it was supposed to be. And I'm satisfied with that, really satisfied.
Well, it hasn't worked out too badly, has it?
No, it hasn't.
I mean,
no, it's
really
lovely. It's wonderful.
Because your career has grown. And I think having this young lady on the dais or the panel or the home base or whatever you want to call it with us, I think you're exposed to a lot of experiences.
Mm-hmm.
Because what she went through, Chita went through, what Liza had to go through to prove her own identity, Because when you live in that shadow, which will always be there, and there's no sense in joking about it, when someone's as famous as her mother was and remains to be, because she was a legend and is a legend in show business, and still create your own identity and create your own thing, that is unbelievable to me. I don't know how you do it. I didn't have it. My old man was too busy shooting pool. But he was the best pool shooter on the block.
All right. There you are.
No, but you know what I'm saying. Everybody in their own way. And it's groovy and marvelous.
You know, Sam, pardon me for a second. It's interesting that we've done a gang of shows in this new series. I think musically tonight on this show, you hit some points that I think will be remembered as long as we have this kind of a TV series, because there were moments tonight musically just great with all of them.
Well, I've said it before, and I gotta stand up to say this. You ladies will have to excuse me for a second, because I just want to say that if you're gonna come to New York, you need a few things going for you. You better have the best musicians, which I have back here. You better have my man, Mr. George Rhodes. You gotta have the sophistication and the golden voice of the mayor of New York, really unofficially, Mr. William B. Williams. Then, to make 90 minutes work, you better have yourself three beautiful, gorgeous ladies like I have on this panel. To Stephanie, to Liza, I thank you. To all of you nice folks out there, I got a couple of more things to say, and we'll be back right after these words, but I got to say these words first. But it's really been a ball, man. Really dynamite. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Frank Jones. Give me a keynote, babe. What good is city alone?